Thank you. The beautiful lecture by Robert Bryant opened with an introduction and an apology for being slightly off topic. This is way off topic. When Fong invited me to speak in this conference, I felt that it was a command performance. Masataki Kurenishi was a wonderful mathematician and a wonderful person, gentle and dauntless. And so I felt that I must accept. On the other hand, unfortunately, for the last several decades, I've done nothing in the fields in which he worked. And so the outcome is that you're going to hear a talk about graphene. On the other hand, there is a Columbia connection, because this is joint work with Sonia Fleiss at Paris and Michael Weinstein at Columbia. So, all right, edge states in graphene. So I'm going to assume that you know a great deal about deformation theory, but nothing about physics. So that's, of course, far from true for many of you. All right, here's document camera would be good now if you could actually see the slides, the handwritten slides. Okay, there they are. Okay, that's graphene. So graphene is a two-dimensional material consisting of carbon atoms where each nucleus is arranged, is situated at one of the vertices of a tiling of the plane by regular hexagons. So this is my attempt to draw that. So the blue dots are the nuclei of the carbon atoms. That's graphene. Now we're going to introduce an edge by cutting the graphene with a knife. And so here is graphene sharply terminated at an edge. So we draw our favorite straight line and we remove all of the stuff that lies on the wrong side of the straight line. And we are left with only the carbon nuclei on the correct side of the straight line. And we want to know how electrons behave given such a material. So that's graphene sharply terminated at an edge. Now, what do electrons actually do? As has been observed and theoretically discussed by physicists, sometimes electrons stay very close to the edge and move very slowly. But whether that happens or not depends very sensitively on the edge. Some edges exhibit that behavior and others not. And that's behavior of great interest in physics and technology. All right, so in this talk, I'm going to explain the tight binding model of the electron in graphene. This is a workhorse of elementary physics. It's been used by physicists since the 1940s, before there was graphene. There was the classic paper is called, well, it's called, I mean, it has in it the word graphite. Okay. The tight binding model, which we'll introduce a little later, is highly oversimplified, but already it predicts many of the key properties of graphene, for example, Dirac points. That means that under the right conditions, an electron can travel through graphene as if it were a relativistic particle traveling through empty space. That's a very unusual thing. And it's predicted by this tight binding model. Okay, now, according to the tight binding model, some edges give rise to flat band edge states and others do not. And we want to decide which edges give rise to flat band edge states, and we want to understand those edge states when they exist. All right, a few slides from now, we're going to see that an edge may be irrational or rational. And we're going to give a complete understanding of flat band edge states. Those are the objects that cause the electrons to stay close to the edge and not move much. We're going to understand that phenomenon completely for all rational edges. And we hope that that can be used as a tool to study irrational edges, because an irrational edge is somehow a limit of rational edges. But so far we have absolutely no results about irrational edges, and that's just a dream. Okay. Now I spoke of flat band edge states without explaining what they are. In a little while, we'll see what they are. But okay, we will see that rational edges usually give rise not only to flat band edge states, but also to non-flat band edge states in which electrons stay close to the edge, but they move quickly instead of moving slowly. Okay, we are not the first people to study graphene with an edge. And I just want to mention here, without explaining what the prior literature does, I just want to mention names. So there are classic papers by these authors you see on the screen, Akhmerov and Benikar, Del Plas, Graf and Porta, Jasolski et al. And these people have studied various edges, not the class of edges that we have studied. Graf and Porta prove rigorous theorems. The others use physical intuition. Okay. All right. I want to mention, but before I get into any content, that our results on the tight binding model of graphene imply corresponding results on the one electron model. That's a model that is also oversimplified compared to reality because it neglects interactions between electrons, among electrons, but it is less oversimplified than the tight binding model. And so there we have a Hamiltonian minus Laplacian plus a potential on acting on wave functions on the plane. And the potential V includes a potential well centered at each site of the terminated graphene. The fact that our results on the tight binding model imply corresponding results on the one electron model is due to these people, James Lee Thorpe, Michael Weinstein, Jacob Shapiro and Michael Weinstein and me. Okay. All right, let's introduce a little bit of content after all that. So let's start by looking a little bit more closely at the geometry of the honeycomb. The honeycomb is just the set of vertices the set of carbon nuclei in a sample of graphene. Okay, so I'm going to show you a color picture of the honeycomb, and you'll notice that the sites can be colored alternately red and green. So the red sites are going to be called A sites, and the green sites are called B sites. And notice that the nearest neighbors of each red dot are three green dots. Notice how they sit. On the other hand, the nearest neighbor of each green dot, the nearest neighbors are three red dots. Notice how they sit. Okay. So let's take a look. All right. So here's a typical green site. That's a B point. And the nearest neighbors of the B point omega are translates of omega by three vectors, E1, E2, and E3, as shown in the picture. On the other hand, the nearest neighbors of an A point, of an orange or a red point, the nearest neighbors of an A point are its translates by minus the same vectors, E1, E2, and E3. Okay. All right. Now, one reason why we distinguish A points from B points is that they are is that the set of A points and also the set of B points are precisely the translates of a lattice. In particular, they are invariant under translation by this lattice. So V1 with a zero on it and V2 with a zero on it, those are two basis vectors for the lattice of translations that take the red dots to the red dots and the green dots to the green dots. Okay, well, so I've spoken about the tight binding model. Let me start to introduce it. So the tight binding model for graphene without an edge. Okay, so this goes back to the classic paper of Wallace in the 1940s, which again long predates the discovery of graphene. I'm going to write omega for the set of all the red and green dots. Omega A is the set of orange dots. Omega B is the set of green dots. Okay, so omega is the union of omega A and omega B. And our Hamiltonian is going to act on wave functions. And a wave function, or a wave vector, I guess I should say, is simply a collection of amplitudes, psi sub omega, for each site omega in the honeycomb. So each omega is either a red dot or a green dot, and each psi omega is simply a single complex number. And we require that these complex numbers are square summable. So that's the space of wave functions on which our Hamiltonian acts. And the Hamiltonian is given by these simple formulas. If you have if you have an A point, then if you have an A point, an orange dot, these are its three nearest neighbors, omega minus E nu, and to calculate the Hamiltonian acting on psi at a given site, all you do is you sum psi itself over the three nearest neighbors. Similarly, the Hamiltonian acting on psi evaluated at a B site, that was, I think, a green dot, that is simply the sum of psi of these translates of omega, so again, the sum over the three nearest neighbors. So that's the tight binding Hamiltonian. So simply, if you were to make a graph in the honeycomb by connecting any two dots that are nearest neighbors to each other, this is of course simply the graph Laplacian on that graph. And so what you want to do is analyze that Hamiltonian. Okay, well, that's what happens if there is no edge. So now let's talk about the tight binding model when there is an edge. Okay. So we have our sharply terminated honeycomb structure. So we started with our graphene. These are the red and green dots. We cut with a knife, and these omega zero is the set of all the dots that lie on the correct side of the cut. And now our wave functions. It would be natural to say that a wave function has an amplitude for each site that lies in omega zero. But in fact, it's convenient to make an obviously equivalent definition in which our wave functions on which the Hamiltonian is going to act are exactly as before without the cut, but instead we impose the condition that all the amplitudes at sites that are not on the right side of the cut are equal to zero. So that's something like Dirichlet boundary conditions, okay? And we require that these be square summable, and that's the Hilbert space on which our Hamiltonian is going to act. And if we make this convention, it's going to make a whole lot of formulas a whole lot simpler in very soon, okay? So those are our wave functions. And our Hamiltonian is simply that for sites that lie on the correct side of the cut, so that they belong to our terminated structure, the Hamiltonian acting on psi at that site is simply the previous Hamiltonian for the non-terminated structure, the Wallace Hamiltonian, the Graf Laplacian acting on psi. But if you are on the wrong side of the cut, then this Hamiltonian acting on psi at the site omega is just zero. That gives rise to the amusing property that the Hamiltonian maps our Hilbert space to itself. That's always good. And in fact, it's trivial to check that this Hamiltonian is a bounded self-adjoint operator. And so what we want to do is to understand the spectral theory of this operator. What are its eigenvalues, or its something like eigenvalues? What are its eigenfunctions? What are its something like eigenfunctions? Well, the spectral theory of that Hamiltonian. So that's in principle a very elementary problem. Now, we are going to take our omega zero to be a half plane with an edge, right? We made a straight line cut. We could have made some sort of jagged cut, and physicists have been interested in jagged cuts. But let's just make a straight line cut, and let's say that V1, the vector V1, is the direction of the edge, as shown in the picture. So this vector V1 is determined up to scalar multiplication. Okay. Now there are two fundamentally different cases. Either our terminated structure is invariant under translation by some non-zero vector V1 in the honeycomb lattice, that's called a rational edge, or it isn't. And so that's called an irrational edge. So remember, there's a lattice of vectors by which omega, the full honeycomb, is translation invariant. And if it happens that there is such a translation that preserves not only omega, but omega zero, then the edge is called rational, and otherwise it's called irrational. There are three classic examples which have been studied very intensively by physicists and by mathematicians. And so I'd like to show them to you. The simplest is called the zigzag edge. So here's our cut, here's our honeycomb, and to see why it's called a zigzag edge, I've drawn these black lines. These are, of course, the black lines connect nearest neighbors, but sort of the boundary of this terminated structure consists of all the dots on the black lines, and the black lines are just a mnemonic. And the cut itself is in, let's say, in that direction. So that's a zigzag edge. Okay, another of the standard cuts is called the armchair cut. There it is. Notice that it looks different from the zigzag cut. Okay, a third example is the bearded zigzag. Here it is, that's the beard. If you compare the bearded zigzag with the zigzag, you'll notice that the direction of the cut for the bearded zigzag is exactly the same as the direction of the cut for the zigzag, but the two cuts, the one that makes the bearded zigzag and the one that makes the ordinary zigzag, are translated from each other. The two cuts are parallel but translated. So the exact position of the cut matters, not just its direction. So we've got the zigzag, the bearded zigzag, and the armchair. Okay, now if an edge is rational, and for almost all the talk, I'll be discussing rational edges. At the very end, I'll mention irrational edges and remind you that we don't know anything about them and speculate a little, just a little. But for a rational edge, there's an important notion of a quasi-momentum. So suppose that our terminated honeycomb is invariant under a translation by some vector V1. Then the Hilbert space L2 of omega zero breaks up naturally as a direct sum of Hilbert spaces called L2K, where K is an angle. It's a real number modulo 2 pi z, and this K is a quasi-momentum. So I'll explain how that works in a minute. It's very simple. And it just reflects the fact that whenever you have an operator that commutes with a translation or something, there is some kind of Fourier analysis you can make. And so the obvious Fourier analysis that we can make will introduce the quasi-momentum. So each L2K, for each K, this Hilbert space is invariant under the action of the Hamiltonian, and the spectral theory that we really want to understand reduces, therefore, to the spectral theory of these guys for each K for each angle in R mod 2 pi z, okay? And so what we're actually doing is understanding these spectral, the spectral theory of this. Okay, what is L2K of omega? It is simply all the wave functions with the property that, well, first of all, they're zero when you're outside the structure. We're studying terminated graphene, not graphene, okay? And if you translate, if you look at psi and you evaluate it at a translated site where you translate by this vector V1 that gave rise to the translational symmetry, that has the effect of multiplying psi by this phase e to the I k. So for example, if k is zero, that means simply that this psi has the same translation symmetry as the underlying structure omega zero, but k needn't be zero, and so there can be a phase. And so that's basic Fourier analysis, okay? All right. Now, all right, people have studied then the spectral theory of the tight binding Hamiltonian acting on L2K. And so I'd like to show you what people know. I mean, it's very well known among people interested in graphene. What happens for an armchair? What happens for a zigzag? And what happens for a bearded zigzag? So I'm going to introduce three drawings. Maybe only two drawings. I'm not sure. Maybe only two drawings. And I have to warn you that these are recycled slides. I was told that there are inaccuracies in the slide, so I'll comment on them. Okay, so here's what the armchair looks like. Let me first explain how to read the picture, and then let me say a few words on the magnificent importance of this picture, and then let me explain what's wrong about it. Okay, so here's the k-axis. K is that parameter in L2K, so it's the quasi-momentum, and let's let it vary from 0 to 2 pi, because it's an angle. Okay, E is the energy, and so that that corresponds to possible eigenvalues of this operator. Okay, now, in order to interpret this picture, what you do is you fix a particular quasi-momentum, and if you want to know what the spectrum of this operator looks like at quasi-momentum k, you fix that k, and you slice this figure with a vertical line through the point k on the k-axis, and the intersection of the green gunk with that line is the spectrum of this operator. And so the spectral theory of this operator is given by this picture. Now, where does the green gunk come from? And the answer is the green gunk is simply the spectrum of the Hamiltonian with quasi-momentum k acting without any termination of the structure. Okay, there is nothing special about the edge that for the armchair. There's nothing special about the edge that doesn't already arise from the bulk. The error in my picture is that line and that line are just wrong. But never mind. The lesson is undisturbed by that error. Okay. By contrast, let's look at the same picture for the zigzag edge. And for the zigzag edge, we have the same green gunk with the same error. These lines are wrong. But again, for a fixed quasi-momentum, intersect with a vertical line, and the intersection of the green region with that vertical line represents the spectrum. How am I doing for time? Oh dear. Okay. Notice, however, that unlike the case of the armchair edge, what we've got here is a horizontal line. In addition to this, that's called a flat band. So the eigenvalue is always zero. And there is a range of quasi-momenta from 2/3 pi to 4/3 pi, for which, in addition to stuff that comes from the bulk, there is spectrum that arises from the edge, from the termination of the structure. That's called a flat band. And if you think about what that means physically, and for example, by looking at the one electron picture instead of the tight binding, and tracing back the correspondence, you can see that what happens is that in this model, the electron sticks to the edge and doesn't move at all. And in the less inaccurate one electron model, it moves exponentially slowly in some parameter that I haven't told you about, but it stays close to the edge for all time. That's the zigzag. I seem to have not included a picture of the bearded zigzag, but for the bearded zigzag, what happens is this line disappears, but there are horizontal lines there on either side of these points. So for the zigzag and the bearded zigzag, there is always at least one flat band. Since 0 and 2 pi are really the same, I guess there's one, this constitutes one flat band. So the zigzag gives rise to a flat band. The bearded zigzag gives rise to a different flat band, but the armchair does not give rise to a different flat band. A flat band edge state simply means a vector psi in the space L2K, corresponding to quasi-momentum K, which is annihilated by the Hamiltonian. It has an eigenvalue zero, and well, because it's in L2K, it's going to decay rapidly as the distance from the edge tends to infinity. So that's what a flat band edge state is. Okay, so flat band edge states are of great interest for science and for technology. One reason they're of great interest is that if you introduce a suitable magnetic field, which we're not going to do today, then electrons move along the edge in one direction and one only. So if you want to make a wire out of graphene, you can cause electrons to move in the direction that in which you tell them to move. And they are of fundamental interest in physics also, because if you have a lot of electrons sitting in one place or moving very slowly, then funny nonlinear effects are promoted and can be studied. Okay, well, so those are the three classical rational edge states, irrational edges. And what I want to describe now are results about arbitrary rational edges. Okay, not just those three examples, but arbitrary rational edges. And what we're going to do is understand the analogs of those three pictures, and we're going to give formulas for the edge states when they exist. And I sincerely hope that it will be possible, with a lot more work, to pass to the limit as our rational edges approach at least some irrational edges. Okay, so what can happen for general flat band edge states for a rational edge? Well, one thing that can happen is the same picture as for the zigzag. There can be this gunk. I neglected to color it green, or did I? No, it's black. So this is the stuff coming from the bulk, but there's a flat band of edge states precisely between quasi-momentum 2/3 pi and 4/3 pi. That can happen for a lot of rational edges. Another thing that can happen for a lot of rational edges is precisely what happens for the bearded zigzag. Oh dear, wait a minute, where am I? Hello? 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 Uh-oh.
Hello, we can hear you, Professor. Hello? Yeah, but the document display are free with.
Hello, 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 hello.
Hello, yes, we can see you now. Can...
Oh my God, how long have I been talking to myself?
That's 10 seconds.
10 seconds, oh good. All right, so just checking. You saw that? Yeah. Oh, wait a minute, wait a minute. Let me get back to the document camera. You saw that?
Yes.
Wonderful. Okay. Oh, that could have been much worse. Let's hope that it won't be much worse. Okay. Here's another thing that can happen for a large class of rational edges. It's exactly the same as the bearded zigzag, namely, this is quasi-momentum 2 pi over 3, this is 4 pi over 3, and in addition to stuff that comes from the bulk, we have flat bands there. And the last thing that happens is the situation of the zigzag. Here, everything comes from the bulk. There are no flat band edge states, okay? But hold on, that's not the complete picture. So there's stuff from the bulk. There are no flat band edge states, but that's not the complete story. All right. So one of our results is that those are regarding flat band edge states, those are the only possibilities for any rational edge. Okay. Furthermore, whenever there are edge states, flat band edge states, either all the non-zero amplitudes occur only at orange dots or they occur only at green dots. Okay. And how are we doing? Okay. And we can tell exactly which of the above scenarios occurs for any given rational edge. And furthermore, when rational edges occur, the space of edge states for a given quasi-momentum is one-dimensional, and we have formulas for the edge states, which gives us non-zero hope that we can somehow slog through a passage to the irrational limit. Okay, but let's not concentrate exclusively on flat band edge states, because when we look at edges, rational edges other than the three classic ones that I mentioned, there are non-flat band edge states. And what that means is that this Hamiltonian restricted to the Hilbert space of quasi-momentum K can have eigenfunctions with non-zero eigenvalues. And so the amplitudes decay rapidly as the distance from the edge tends to infinity. And so these are electrons that stick to an edge but move quickly. And so here's one picture of how the spectrum might look in such a case. And so we have stuff coming from the bulk, but then we have these guys. Okay. Another possibility is that we have these guys. So now there are flat band edges or not, and we understand exactly how they occur. And there are also a lot of non-flat band edges. How confident are we that that's correct? Well, regarding flat band edges, we have theorems and proofs. Regarding non-flat band edges, we've done computer simulations, and they look reliable. We've been in conversation with an expert, Javi Gomez Serrano, who tells us that he's confident that he can make our numerics into a computer-assisted proof to show that the non-flat band edge states exist as we claim. But so far, there's no proof. Okay. Now, how do we do all this? Well, you may have noticed this is all a completely elementary problem. When I explained to Fong that I won't be able to talk about something related to Kuranishi, he said, that's okay as long as there's deep PDE. And there isn't. These are simple difference equations. To work out any particular case is a routine calculation. But as as the numbers get larger, the difficulty of the routine calculation increases real fast. And so there's a reason, I think, why people didn't study general edges. And it requires ideas. But in the end, everything is completely elementary, surprisingly elementary. So, all right, how do the computations work? I won't give you a complete explanation. I will maybe get just to the edge of the heart of the matter and then not dive in. Okay, so the first thing is just to specify the edge in the right setting. And the setting I introduced, the standard one, is not optimized. Once we've got the right setting, we can read off the difference equations, and they look much better than they would if we hadn't taken this first step. Once we read off the difference equations, we solve them. And that gives rise to complete information on where flat band edge states occur. Once that happens, we simply guess formulas for the edge states. And in retrospect, one can see why we should have seen them, but in fact, we just guessed them. And once you guess them, you can check that they're correct. All right, so I would like to explain most of this in the remaining, 13 minutes, 23 minutes, 23 minutes. I'll leave a little time for questioning also. Okay, so first of all, how do we specify the edge? Remember, the honeycomb lattice is generated as a lattice by two vectors that have zeros over them. And so here, for example, these are in some system of units, these vectors will work. So that's the lattice with respect to which the honeycomb is invariant. Okay, now our rational edge is parallel to some vector V1. And we decided that V1 should lie in the lattice lambda h because the edge is rational. Why does opium cause sleep? Because it is a soporific. So that's why V1 lies in lambda h. And so it is given by two coefficients that I'm calling A11 and A12 times these vectors. And if this V1 actually lies in the lattice and not just in the plane, these guys are integers. And we can take, of course, since V1 is determined up to scalar multiple, we can take out any common divisor of these. And so we can take them to be relatively prime. Once that happens, V1 is uniquely determined up to sine. So this is the minimal translation vector, and it is assumed that these coefficients are integers. Now, because they are relatively prime, we can find two more integers with a property that this matrix has determinant plus or minus one. And then we're going to use a second basis vector. V1 is one of them, and V2 is the other. We're going to set V2 equal to these other coefficients times the V10 and V20, as shown on the slide. Okay, so now we've got two vectors, V1 and V2. V1 is parallel to the edge. V2 is transverse to the edge. These coefficients are integers, and this determinant is plus or minus one. Let's specify a little more closely. By possibly changing V2 to minus V2, we can make sure that V2 points into the bulk. So it points in the direction of the terminated structure. And once we've done that, then possibly changing V1 to minus V1, we can make this determinant equal to plus one. And so by doing that little song and dance, we have achieved that we have two vectors, V1 and V2, like this. They are linear combinations of the original vectors, V10 and V20, and the matrix that takes us from the vectors with zero on them to vectors without a zero on them is of determinant one with integer entries, and therefore V1 and V2 serve also as a lattice basis. And it's a very, very simple idea, but very natural, but people didn't notice it before. Let's express everything in terms of that basis, and life is going to get a lot simpler. All right, once we've got that basis, I'm going to look at the terminated structure. In order to look at the terminated structure, we're going to partition the plane into parallelograms. So a single parallelogram, gamma MN, is the set of points in the plane which are expressed as linear combinations of our V1 and V2 with components X and Y, where M is the nearest integer to X and N is the nearest integer to Y. So M and N are integers. The good news there is that each one of those parallelograms contains a single A point, a single orange point, which I'm going to call A of MN, and a single B point, a single green point that I'm going to call B of MN. And the honeycomb structure, before we cut it with a knife, consists of all the AMN and all the BMN for M and N integers. Here's a little picture. Okay, so V1 is this vector. Here's the cut. We make that cut with the knife. And if we look at the shaded region, then all of the red and green dots, which I haven't drawn, But all of the red and green dots that lie in that shaded region, that's our, that's what we're studying. That's our terminated sample of graphene. And here we're dividing the world into parallelograms according, I mean, the sides of the parallelograms correspond to the V1 and the V2. And each parallelogram contains a single red or orange dot and a single green dot. That's the picture. Okay. Now let's analyze the bulk, just the geometry of the bulk in terms of those vectors. The edge is parallel to V1, V2 points into the bulk. And so the terminated honeycomb, it consists of all points of the non-terminated honeycomb, which can be expressed like that, where the V2 component Y is greater than some cutoff value beta. And from that, it follows easily that our honeycomb consists of all these A points and all these B points, where N is greater than or equal to some minimum value for all that course that applies to the A points. And here N is greater than or equal to some other value that corresponds to the B points. And these numbers can be read off, and they are sometimes equal and sometimes they differ by one. Okay, so now we have a simple description of what the truncated honeycomb is. Okay, now we have to understand nearest neighbors, because the Hamiltonian is defined in terms of nearest neighbors. So the nearest neighbors of AMN, that's an A point. And so there are three B points, and they are A, where M and N are translated by three different integer vectors, M nu, N nu for nu equals 1, 2, 3. Similarly, the nearest neighbors of a given B point are these three A points, where M and N are translated by minus the same integer vectors. And these M nu and N nu are computable without real difficulty from this matrix of A's. Okay, so now we know what the terminated structure looks like, and we know what the nearest neighbors are. And now let's see what does a wave function look like. Well, a wave function for graphene without any termination can be written just as, let's say, amplitudes Psi A of Mn and Psi B of Mn for arbitrary integers M and N, where Psi A of Mn is the amplitude at the A site in parallelogram MN, and CB of MN is the amplitude at the B site in that parallelogram. And so this is just another way of writing wave functions. And now the tight binding Hamiltonian for the terminated structure acts on such vectors, but not all vectors. But remember, whenever a site does not belong to the terminated structure, the amplitude is zero. And so we are looking at such vectors subject to the restriction that the A part of the amplitude is zero if N is less than this minimum value N min A, and C B, the B amplitude, is zero for N less than the minimum value of that N can take in the structure for B sites. Okay, so that's the Hilbert space on which our tight binding Hamiltonian acts. And for such psi, here are the simple rules. If N is greater than or equal to N A min, that means this guy is in the structure. And so we evaluate the ordinary Hamiltonian, not taking into account the termination. And that's what happens for an A site if N is greater than or equal to N min A. But if N is less than N min A, then we're outside the structure. And this had better be zero, because we want to end up in the right Hilbert space. And analogously for B points, except that instead of translating there, you translate by minus the vectors. And notice that that's an N min A and that's an N min B. So this all looks very elementary. It is all very elementary. We now want to look at the effect of quasi-momentum. So for a given quasi-momentum, for a wave function to have quasi-momentum k, it means that the m dependence is just exponential like that. And okay, and so really, instead of instead of our amplitudes being psi A of Mn and psi B of Mn, we can just look at psi A of N and psi B of N. And so now we're going to think of L2K as consisting of vectors like that, but with the condition, right? Well, here. So now our Hamiltonian is going to act on vectors like that, indexed only by N, not by M, such that the A amplitude is zero for N less than the minimum N for A, and the B amplitude is zero for N less than the minimum possible for B sites. So that's the Hilbert space on which H acts. And if you just remember that translating by M introduces a phase factor, then these formulas show you what the Hamiltonian is. Okay. And so our problem is to understand that that difference, those difference equations. Okay, so that's our Hamiltonian. Well, what difference equations? An edge state with quasi-momentum K and energy E is a vector as described above, with the property that if you apply the Hamiltonian, you get E times C. So it's an eigenvector. And here you want these guys to tend to zero rapidly as N tends to infinity so that this guy is in L2. So that's an edge state. And the problem is to find edge states. So the equations for an edge state are simply these. It doesn't look complicated. Well, I hope it doesn't look complicated. These are just elementary difference equations. And now let's specialize and make life even simpler. Let's specialize to flat band edge states, E equals zero. And if E equals zero, here's our problem. So I give you a moment to look at it while I look at how little time remains. Okay, notice that the upper box pertains only to the B sites and the lower box pertains only to the A sites. And so these two problems are completely uncoupled. And so if you want to know whether you have a flat band edge, edge state, you can look separately at the B sites and at the A sites and they have nothing to do with each other. It turns out that whenever there is an A site, whenever the A site problem has a non-trivial solution, in other words, the psi's aren't simply identically zero, whenever the A site problem has a solution, the B site problem doesn't, and vice versa. So you're always you've always got either edge states that live only on A sites or edge states that live only on B sites. Okay, we're going to deal in the remaining time only with the B sites, and the A sites are analogous. Okay, now there are these three integer vectors, m nu, n nu, for nu equals 1, 2, 3, and I'm going to number those vectors in such a way that n1 is the smallest, then n2, and finally n3. And except for the classic zigzag edge and the bearded edge and trivial variants of those, rotations of those by angular symmetries of the honeycomb. Except for such edges, they're all distinct. Notice that you can't achieve this if two of them are the same, but they never are except in known cases. And furthermore, except in known cases, N1 is negative and N3 is positive, and that turns out to matter. Okay. So, well, here's a difference equation that we're trying to solve. And of course, any competent math undergraduate can tell you that in order to solve that difference equation, you should look at this polynomial equation, you should look at this equation, and N1 is negative, so it's not a polynomial equation, but you look at this equation for unknown zeta, okay? Let's make it a polynomial equation. So we simply divide by the first monomial. And if we do that, then without loss of generality, this is the equation where beta 1 is the difference of two of the m's, beta 2 is, again, the difference of two of the m's, and the gammas are differences of two of the n's. And so these betas and gammas are integers. The gammas are ordered, they're both positive and they're ordered like that. And this determinant is plus or minus one because the determinant of the a's is plus one. And so we want to understand the solutions of this equation. This is now a polynomial equation of degree gamma two. So, okay, a few minutes to go. Here are the roots of the polynomial equation. They lead to solutions like that of the difference equations. And again, this is undergraduate stuff. Okay, so that's, these AJs are just arbitrary coefficients. Now our difference equation is not supposed to hold for all n, but only for n greater than or equal to n min a. And what that means is that at the B sites, the amplitudes are given by that formula, but not for all n, only for n greater than or equal to n min a plus n1. Okay, for n less than n min a plus n1, cbn can be anything without affecting the difference equation.
Professor Pfefferman, I think you started like 5 minutes later, so you have a week.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. We want solutions that tend rapidly to zero as n tends to infinity. And so then instead of summing this quantity over all the roots, we only sum over the roots that lie in the open unit disk, because then as n goes to plus infinity, these guys go rapidly to zero rather than say going rapidly to infinity. Okay. So that's our formula whenever n is greater than or equal to n min a plus n1. Okay, well, recall our edge states are also supposed to satisfy that the b amplitudes are zero whenever n is less than n min b. So that means that the b site amplitudes of a flat band edge state at a given quasi-momentum k have to be of the following form. There's our formula. We're summing not over all the zeros, but only over the zeros of the polynomial in the open unit disk. And this is supposed to be true for n greater than or equal to that. And on the other hand, cb of n is equal to zero for n less than n min b. Now you might ask, which of these numbers is bigger and which is smaller, that or that? And the answer is that one is smaller than that one. And so there are consistency conditions for these, namely, okay, so these a's are undetermined coefficients. The zeta 1 to zeta p are the roots of our polynomial equations in the open unit disk. And we have the consistency, we must satisfy the consistency conditions that wherever we have two different formulas for the amplitude, namely, if the amplitude is equal to zero and yet the amplitude is given by that sum had better be zero. Okay, so the a's have to satisfy these equations. And the space of flat band edge states is precisely identified with the space of all solutions of these equations. Now, these equations look suspiciously like a Vandermonde system. Its determinant is a Vandermonde system. The only issue is, are there more equations than unknowns? Are there more unknowns than equations? Are there equally many equations or unknowns? And so we have learned that if the number of equations, well, if this is true, then the number of equations is greater than or equal to the number of unknowns. And so there are no edge states living on the B sites. If, on the other hand, the reverse inequality holds, okay, that means there are more equations than unknowns, and then the space of B site flat band edge states has dimension, the difference between these two things, the number of equations minus the number, I'm sorry, number of unknowns minus the number of equations. Okay, now all of these, all of the numbers here, n1, n min a, n min b, they're all easily computed from this matrix and from that number beta, remember, that determined exactly where the cut is, not just its direction. So these are, once you specify the problem, you can compute all of these. But there's this number p P is the number of zeros of this polynomial in the open unit disk. Okay. And so it looks as if the life is simple and elementary and everything is swell, but all of a sudden we've got this polynomial and we have to know how many zeros lie in the open unit disk. How on earth are we going to compute that? Well, here the betas and gammas are integers. The gammas are positive and satisfy that. The betas satisfy that. And we use the key fact, which I have not enough minutes to explain, but the number of roots of this polynomial is given by an elementary formula. And in fact, the roots themselves are given by elementary formulas. So that's as far as I can tell, a sheer stroke of luck from the special structure of this equation. And so here is the number of, here's the formula for the number of zeros. So remember, we're given the polynomial with betas and gammas. We add the gammas together and we declare that that's equal to S hat mod 3, where S hat is plus or minus 1 or 0, okay? And we're going to exclude a few bad quasi-momenta. The slides are recycled. In the previous version, there were two other bad quasi-momenta determined by the edge, but in fact, there aren't. These are the only cases not already resolved. And simply, this is a completely elementary formula in terms of stuff that we can easily compute. I do not at all have time to explain, but just to see that there's a ray of hope. Regarding this equation, the bad news is that gamma 2 may be large, so this is a high degree equation, but the good news is that there are only three terms. And so I wonder if somebody in, let's say, the 16th century analyzed polynomial equations with only three terms. I don't know. But one can understand the zeros, and they are given by elementary formulas, and in particular, so both the zeros themselves and the count of the number of zeros, we can do that. And that's why we can decide which rational edges and which quasi-momenta give rise to flat band edge states. I have a few slides which enable us to see which is which, and I think I'm going to skip them. There is an elementary answer. You can take a given edge and just decide by doing a very, very simple little computation what's going on. So let me skip a few slides. And we are, I think, almost done. I have at least five more minutes. Okay, I would like to leave a little time for questions. Let me show you formulas for the flat band edge states. I think that's a separate idea, and just it's worth looking at the formulas. Well, I hope. All right, so we fix an edge and we fix a quasi-momentum, and we look at cases in which there are flat band edge states. If there aren't any, we don't have to find formulas for them, okay? So now I'm going to use the symbol I to denote A or B, whichever kind of dots the flat band edge state lives on. It always lives either only on the A sites or only on the B sites. And so C of N without an A or B just means the relevant C, the C of N where this I is either A or B depending on which color dots actually have non-zero amplitudes. Okay, so remember our amplitudes are zero for N less than some critical number N sub I. So what we want to do is produce formulas for flat band edge states of the form C equals C of N for n greater than or equal to n min I. Warning, those Cs, I'm going to show you formulas for eigenvectors, but they're not normalized eigenvectors, okay? And each formula comes with its own favorite n min I, which you have to work out. All right, so here are the formulas. So remember, we've got these roots, zeta 1 to zeta p, and they are the roots of this polynomial equation. And we know how to read them off by inverting the elementary function. Oops, I haven't discussed that elementary function, never mind. But we know in principle how to find zeta 1 to zeta p. So here is the first formula. Okay, it is an integral over angles. Well, it is the It is the nth Fourier coefficient of this function of theta. That's C of n. Okay, here is formula two. So remember, C of n is like that. That's no surprise. But what are these a's? Well, they're given by that very simple formula. Okay, there is a third formula that I'm not going to mention. So we have, in fact, three formulas for the edge states once they occur. We know exactly when they occur. And remember, we also have numerical results that seem to indicate, based on computer simulations, that edge states with non-zero energy can occur for certain rational edges. In fact, we've by now looked at, I don't know, several dozen rational edges. And our experience is that the classical edges studied many, many times by physicists and mathematical physicists, those three classical cases are the only cases in which we do not find non-flat band edge states. Okay, well, what about irrational edges? And for the, I don't know, for the third or fourth time, let me just say that we would very much like to take our results for rational edges and pass somehow to the limit as our rational edges approach suitable irrational edges, maybe with some Diophantine properties for their slopes, and say something about the spectral theory for those. And well, we would like to do that, and we have not even begun. Okay, and thank you for listening, especially since this is very far from the interests of the people at this conference. I had and have the greatest respect for Kurenishi, and so I did not want to decline the invitation to speak, even though everything I have to say is so far from the relevant subject. Okay, so thank you.
Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you. It's not so easy to make out what you're saying, but I can hear you.
Yeah, thanks for amazing talk. I have multiple questions. One is that you solved for this energy dispersion, and it seems like near the points for the Brillouin zone.
Like, yes.
You got like the Dirac cone structure. Is it also maintained if the graphene is allowed to like relax in a physical environment? Because I think it wouldn't stay planar, right? Like the bonds would be like going up and down.
Oh, okay. So I guess in a physical environment, let's see, I've been warned that the lattice is not perfect. And for that matter, it doesn't lie exactly in a plane.
Exactly my question.
Yeah. So, okay. Given that, I mean, let's see. The safest thing for me to say is that I haven't the faintest idea. Let me try to say something a little more useful. The tight binding model has to be reinterpreted. I guess if you're not very careful, if you're not very careful, the tight binding model is just wrong when the lattice is disturbed. So I guess the potential wells have to be deep, but not too deep, depending on how much the lattice is perturbed. What happens? I would guess, but I can't promise. I would guess that the results still hold if you're very careful about exactly what you mean, because still each site has three nearest neighbors. That's the basic thing that allows it to happen. So I think if you're very careful, there is a version of this for a distorted lattice. Now that's that means still in the plane and still idealized compared to real graphene. So, so I haven't the faintest idea is wrong. I have the faintest idea. I think that some version of this can be rescued if you perturb the lattice a little bit and you imagine that, let's say, there are slightly different distances between nearest neighbors, and so there are slightly different hopping coefficients. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thanks.
Okay.
And the next is that if you, again, physical thing, typically there'll be more than one layer. Like, it's very difficult to get single. So have you worked out any computations?
We would love to work out bilayer graphene. One reason we want to do irrational edges is that I think that's perhaps the simplest system beyond a rational cut with one layer of graphene. Bilayer graphene is going to have similar issues in a much tougher form. So you know, maybe someday, but certainly not now. I have nothing to say about more than one layer. Sorry.
Thank you.
Sure.
Any other questions?
Hey, Professor, can you hear me?
Yes.
So if you consider like a Hermitian matrices, so for example, if you have like two Hermitian matrices, and then if you sum it up, so and then consider the eigenvalues, that give you like a honeycomb structure, right?
I'm sorry, so you have two Hermitian operators?
No, for example, if you have like a Hermitian matrices.
Oh, Hermitian matrices, okay.
And if you sum it up, and then you consider the eigenvalues, so I think it's something really like Terence Tao's.
There is nothing, as far as I know, there is not the slightest connection. There is the word honeycomb.
What's that?
That's all.
No,
it's very different stuff.
Oh yeah, I'm just thinking about being applied. Okay, sure.
Okay. Oh, would this apply to that or vice versa? I really doubt it.
Sure. Thank you.
It would be very nice if, but I don't see. It's of course always very dangerous to say that any two things are unrelated. That statement is almost always false, but I don't see any connection. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you.
Sure.
Any other questions? Yeah, if no other questions, let's thank Professor Bachmann again.
Bye-bye.